we'll start this morning. We have just a couple of announcements. And the first one is that consistory will be this Thursday. It's the monthly meeting. It'll be the July 15th at 7 p.m. with the financial committee meeting at 6:30. And we will have a guest speaker with us on Sunday, July 25th. Please join us at 10:30 in the morning as we welcome Wyoming cowboy preacher James Scott. That's all I have. Are there any other announcements, Bob?
I just wanted to make an announcement on behalf of the search committee. In the first meeting of the search committee, we put down on paper the purpose statement for the search committee, and I'd like to read you that statement. It's to follow the leading of the Holy Spirit and commit to fervent prayer to find a new senior pastor for Zion Church that will preach God's word and love and minister to the people of Zion Church and the community. The committee would like to thank you all for your prayers, and we've been meeting nearly once a week, sometimes not quite that often, but pretty close to that. And we've looked at somewhere near 20 resumes so far, but then narrowing them down as the Spirit leads us. We ask you to continue to pray for us and for the applicants. Pray that the Holy Spirit opens doors and leads us to the pastor that God already has picked out for us. And pray for the applicants as they follow the leading of the Holy Spirit also. Thank you.
After the last, it's been many weeks. This has been in your bulletin for the last several Sundays. I was reluctant to come before the congregation of Roger's departure, 4th of July, and everything else. So here, as we end the days of 40 days of prayer for growing nations, probably a bit late, but I just thought I'd explain, growing nations is the NGO that Sue and I serve with in Lesotho. They're going through changes. COVID has set them back just like every other ministry in the world. So they're asking for 40 days of prayer. The nice thing about the 40 days of prayer is it's really giving a good overview of growing nations, starting with a scriptural verse and then a vision that each year our growing nations tithes 10% of their harvest to the local church. And that image there is the grains that were brought into the church. It's just bringing grain to the church, not dollars. Or, of course it's not dollars, it's not the United States. But, and then the excitement and the dancing that always ensues. So if you're interested, I have every one of these 40 days of prayer. I can make them available to you. They're on the church. Many of you are receiving them on the prayer list. The church prayer chain. So just that's all I have, and please pray for growing nations. Thanks.
I just want to thank Jamie and Matt. Yesterday we had concessions out at the ballpark for the softball team, and Jamie and Matt came out and spent all day out there serving people and taking care of people for us. I want to thank them.
I just wanted to thank you guys all for praying for my mother. I have a praise, I won't cry. My mother is doing excellent. My mother saw the oncologist on Friday, and he said, go out and enjoy your life. Come back and see me in 3 months. We'll do scans. She's had chemotherapy. She's had radiation. She feels great, and she wants to do things. She's like up for everything. And so, your prayers have been awesome. Thank you for, as a church body, my family, that you have prayed for my mother. And she is doing wonderful, and she's always been in the Lord's hands, and her life on this earth is continuing in the Lord's hands. But I just wanted to say thank you and praise God.
Any other announcements? Excuse me. If not, if you would please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful day that you have created. We will rejoice in it and be glad, Lord. And we thank you for your faithfulness to us and your guidance and our being our constant guide and companion. We just ask, Lord, that everything that is said and done today, whether it's through a spoken word or music, it will raise your name up so that we can praise and worship you, Heavenly Father. We ask that you be with Matt and speak to us through him, Lord, and make him a willing vessel so he can do just that. We pray these things in your holy name. Amen. Today's call to worship is brought to us from the book of Psalms, chapter 92, verses 1 through 5. It is good to praise the Lord and make music to your name, O Most High, proclaiming your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night, to the music of the ten-string lyre and melody of the harp. For you make me glad by your deeds, Lord. I sing for joy at what your hands have done. How great are your works, Lord. How profound your thoughts.
Would you please stand and join us as we begin worshiping the Lord?
Sold grain to the Egyptians, for the famine was severe throughout Egypt. and all the world came to Egypt to buy grain from Joseph, because the famine was severe everywhere.
Thank you. If you would now join me as we state what we believe by reciting the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the one and only universal Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. If you would please join me once again as we recite the prayer that Christ taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
thank you, Lord, that you are so faithful to us, because without that, Lord, we could not get back to you. And so we just ask, Lord, that you bless what we have brought today to give back to you. And we ask you, Lord, to use it to spread your word, to spread your glory throughout not only the whole world, Lord, but right here in Worland also, Heavenly Father. Please bless the gift and the giver. We pray this in your name. Amen.
We don't want the seeds we want you. It is you. Now, before we pray, just like to bring attention that we will be praying for Joe Vigil because he has a back surgery tomorrow morning. Now, I don't think it's major. There's some kind of piece of a bone that's missing, and I don't know the medical term for this, but that's how Christy described it to me. We'll also be praying for the search committee that they get guidance. We also need to pray for people that may be hurting. I don't even necessarily want to say who. I know it's called out specific people, but people that feel lonely in their lives right now. And of course, we want to praise the Lord in our prayer for what he has done with Kay King's mother. And that is just very encouraging for me this morning, I must say. So if you would please join me in prayer. Lord Father, our great and mighty God, King of the universe, you who have revealed yourself in so many ways through your creation to us, testifying that there is a creator and that it cannot be denied without bringing condemnation on the denier. Lord, we want to thank you for revealing yourself in your word. Today, we will enjoy some of that, Lord, and we want to thank you for giving us this, expressing yourself, the infinite and almighty God that we can't even wrap our minds around, but through your word, Lord, you have allowed us to touch you and get close to you and tell us about yourself and your ways and your plans for us in a form that we can understand, Lord, that you brought down to us and yet nevertheless conveys who you are. So we want to praise you for that, Lord. Father, we come before you this morning as those who love your Son, Jesus Christ, and as this local body of Christ. And we would like to ask you to please be with the vigils tomorrow morning. Lord, please help the surgeons guide their hands as they operate on Joe's back. And then, Lord, we ask that he is able to heal quickly. Please bring a sense of peace before and after the operation to both him and Christy. Build them up and strengthen them and help them to follow you all the more after he will surely recover from this surgery. So, Lord, we thank you that we live in a time and there are instruments available and people with the right skills that can bring healing to Joe, but we also trust that ultimately you will be his great healer and guide. So we ask that you please be with both of them during this time. Lord, we also ask that you please help place your guiding hand in the search committee and bless their efforts and make their desire, which of course has been expressed, but make it all the more so that they seek to do ultimately what you would have them do. Lord, we also would like to praise your glorious name, Father, for bringing some healing and some joy to Kay King's mother. Father, we know that she was in a tough situation, so we just want to say thank you that you have caused her to feel great. We also would ask, though, that you continue to heal her, stave off cancer, and strengthen her body. And Lord, we'd like, please ask you to keep her around for some time before she comes home to you, Lord, and help just bring peace to her family and give them some joy and excitement. So we want to thank you, though, for this great miracle that you provided, Lord Father. And Lord, thank you for the music and the fellowship and those who are volunteering this morning to usher. And we just want to thank you for everyone here. And we ask that all of this service ultimately be used to build each of us up to know you better and to make your name known. And these things we praise and ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Children's church, please use it. Yeah, I'm going to have to get used to the transition time because it's pastoral prayer and then sermon, but usually the person doing the sermon wasn't the same during the prayer, so it's kind of like a mental block where you're like, okay, now walk over here. All right, this morning I want to discuss, in the broad picture, this idea that all of Scripture points to Messiah Jesus, to Jesus Christ. It's really all centered around him. And I think it's helpful that instead of thinking of Scripture in a line, sort of a linear line of events, which I must say I tend to think of it that way, and that's not wrong, but it's also helpful to think of Scripture, especially for our purposes this morning, as a bicycle wheel. Now think, envision this will in your mind. The tire itself is scripture. And the frame, I suppose, because I don't know what else to do with the frame. But, and there are more spokes than you can count descending from the frame toward the center. And they're all connecting in this hub, and there's all these spokes in the hub, in that wheel. And that hub is Christ. And this is a good and proper way to understand God's word. So all these spokes connect to the Lord, our Savior Jesus, in different ways from different parts of the wheel that is scripture. So some might be really obvious, right? You might say, well, you know, Pastor, you see this verse where it talks about Jesus. That seems like a pretty direct spoke. And I would say, yes, yes it is. But there are also other spokes that may not so clearly point to him, but in fact do. And we have such good scriptural evidence for this. And it really helps your understanding of the Bible and can help you appreciate it and therefore help you connect through Jesus yourself. Now, these spokes can be all sorts of things. Appearances of the Lord himself, prophecies, people, events, etc. Now, this morning, we're going to look at one spoke in particular, the patriarch Joseph. We're going to kind of look at a very brief overview of his life. And I mean very brief, because I have to fight that temptation, I tell you. I see a lot of these passages on his life as I'm preparing this. I go, oh, I'm going to talk about this too. Oh, and this. But for your sake, I've cut out much of it. I just tried to keep some very key things. Now, Joseph was rejected by his brothers, and he suffered in prison. But he was ultimately raised up to rule over Egypt, and he saved the lives of countless people in the Middle East. Joseph became the savior of the world. Now, if any of you go, it sounds kind of blasphemous, I ask you just to stick with me till the end of the sermon, then make your judgment on that. We'll begin with Genesis 37, 3 through 4. Now, Israel loved Joseph more than all his sons because he was the son of his old age. And he made him a vari-colored tunic. His brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, and so they hated him and could not speak to him on friendly terms. Now, the Hebrew for the vari-colored tunic, if you were to dig down into it, it most likely means a tunic that's made of lots of pieces of cloth. And it's each of these chunks sewn together, and they may be different colors. So it's very colored in that it's made from lots of different pieces of cloth. So in the Near East at this time, a multicolor robe, or any kind of robe that was made of multiple colors, was supposed to be the sign of a tribal chief, someone of great prominence, an authority in the community, someone who was close to being a king, perhaps not quite, but close to that level of prominence. One may say, if you were to be in Egypt, close to being a pharaoh, just as it's in. Now, the very fact that such a coat would indicate someone who was the head of a tribe, that might upset someone's older brothers. It might get under their skin that the dad gives this, it's actually his second youngest son, just to deal with that issue. Some of you might think, but Benjamin is younger than Joseph. Yes, but Rachel died giving birth to Benjamin. So the text doesn't say, but I suspect unfairly this sort of influenced Israel, Jacob's thoughts. Now later, after Joseph, he thinks Joseph is dead, he starts to really love Benjamin. So I'm not saying he doesn't love him, but I can only figure that's why he favored Joseph, because he's the son of his old age, but he's actually, there was one younger, but again, the incident with Rachel, it was probably just a hard memory to deal with. Now, the many colors themselves, we may also say, are associated with God ruling the universe from his throne. Let's look at Revelation 4, 2 through 3. Immediately, I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne was standing in heaven, and one sitting on the throne. And he who was sitting was like a jasper stone and a sardius in appearance. And there was a rainbow around the throne, like an emerald in appearance. It's often thought that this is meant to symbolize, although this is a very real thing, all of the colors of creation being around the throne of God. Yes, they represent his mercy in the flood. He puts the bow in the sky as sort of an indication that despite the evil things you do, I won't flood the earth again. But they also represent his authority over all things. And this is typically how rainbow colors are used in scripture, to be indicative of God's authority. And at this moment, if some of you were thinking, wow, how interesting is it then that the homosexual community would use it to push their views? Yes, I believe that's the purpose, to appropriate something that is supposed to represent God's authority. Now, all of the spectrum of the universe is under his authority. We know from John 1:3 that all things were created through Jesus, the Word of God. And in him, all things in the universe are held together, according to Colossians 1:17. So it is right that this color spectrum that represents all authority is so associated with our Lord. But here we have Jacob's son clothed in glory, sort of indicative of that. His appearance is a picture of our Lord Jesus, the only begotten son with whom the Father is well pleased. Jacob is very pleased with Joseph, and yet it's sort of a little shadowy picture of God the Father's love for Jesus. Clothed with the glory of God, one with actual divine power, divine glory that I couldn't begin to wrap my mind around, and one with a robe that sort of symbolizes that kind of authority and love. Now, remember in John 17, the high priestly prayer? Well, in it, Jesus prayed to the Father, saying in verse 5, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory which I had with you before the world was. Now, Joseph's coat itself was a sign of his father Israel's special love. Joseph's brothers knew it, and it brought hate to their hearts because there's jealousy involved. Their father loves their brother more than them. And they couldn't even speak to him respectfully. Now, some Jewish scholars interpret this to mean they couldn't even say shalom to him, meaning that just a very basic hello, like, how have you been? They didn't even actually have to really like him, but they couldn't even bring themselves to be pleasant with their own brother because of this. Now, and this I suspect will amuse you. It's in this context that Joseph had a dream and decided to tell it to his brothers. Remember, the context is they're not happy with it. In the dream, Joseph and his brothers, they're all binding sheaves of wheat together. They're all farmers. They're binding these sheaves of wheat. And then Joseph tells them, but in my dream, my sheave, it just sort of stands erect. And then all of the sheaves that you bound together bow down to my sheave. Now, this might not surprise you, but Joseph's brothers, they didn't care for the dream. That's a way to understand. Then Joseph decided to tell his brothers about another dream. You know, I'll tell you, he just didn't know when to stop. Here's the other dream. Now it's very simple. In this dream, the sun and the moon and 11 stars all bowed down to Joseph. The meaning is clear. The sun and the moon often represent mother and father in the ancient Near East, the symbolism. 11 stars. There's 12 sons of Israel, 12 sons of Jacob. Well, there's 11 of them were bowing to Joseph. I think they understood what I meant. Soon after, some of the brothers decided to kill Joseph. They were like, that's it. He's got to go. We can't have this. But ultimately, they decided to sell him into slavery. You know, one of the brothers, Reuben, was like, you know, I feel really bad if we murdered him. So let's throw him into a pit. And then he may save himself. I mean, it's kind of interesting wording. They're like, what if he doesn't? What's the logic here? But, you know, Reuben is being more reasonable. Let's just get him in a pit. Let's not murder him. But anyway, while Reuben's away, some of the other brothers go, you know what? Let's just sell him into slavery because then we get some money. And we get rid of him. And that's a win-win. So they sold him into slavery to some passing by Ishmaelites, descendants of Ishmael. Very interesting parallel since they're descendants of a different family line with Abraham. But he ends up a slave in Egypt. The brothers took the multicolored robe and they dipped it in blood and they poured blood all over. so they could lie to their father Israel and say that an animal had killed Joseph. Joseph's own family, the people of Israel, in fact, the patriarchs of each tribe, forsook him and cast him away, even though he was their rightful leader. The glorious robe, pointing to the glory of Messiah, was now covered in blood. And Joseph's father mourned bitterly over the loss of his most beloved son. And though Joseph wasn't actually dead, he may as well have been to his father, because as far as his father knew, he was. So he just grieved bitterly. And really, we read until Jacob finds out he's alive, years and years later, he can never get over it. Just losing Joseph like that. Thinks he's been torn apart by an animal. And it's, I think with anyone who's lost children, it is, you can sympathize to some degree with this. Now, the rejection of Joseph and the bloody coat, we could say, could be a rejection of God himself. Because Joseph's dreams didn't come from his own mind. This wasn't just him bragging. It seems like it, I admit it. But, in fact, these dreams come from God. The brothers of Israel, then, represent the rejection of God by his own creation. More specifically, they represent their own ancestors later rejecting the Messiah, the King of multicolored glory. So we sort of have a foreshadow of Jesus' first coming. He came to his brothers. I'm here. I'm your king. I can't wait to bring you the kingdom. And they were like, crucify him. No, we don't recognize your authority. And so he's rejected. Now in his new role, meanwhile, back to Joseph. In his new role, he is lied about. He actually does well as a slave. He's raised to prominence as a slave. But there's some lies told about him. He's thrown into prison. It's very typical. We'll see with men of God. There's often some kind of slander that comes against them, moves against them. Now, of course, Joseph's gift of interpreting dreams serves him well. And after spending years in prison, word got out to Pharaoh about his abilities. Now, Pharaoh himself had recently had two dreams, and I'm sure many of you remember this. The first one is he sees seven fat cows coming out of the Nile. And you know, and the scripture says fat and sleek. And you know, it's just such imagery of this sort of fat. I don't know what they mean necessarily by sleek, to be honest with you, but I'm like, I guess kind of just oily and kind of thick. And they're coming out of the Nile, which is an interesting picture of cows. And then seven gaunt cows come out, and they look like they're starving. And they're like, you know, zombie-like in appearance cows. And they come out, and then they eat the fat cows. Similarly, yeah, I know, it's a weird dream, but we've all had weird dreams. Similarly, Pharaoh beheld seven ears of plump grain being consumed by thin ears that look kind of windswept and unhealthy. So Pharaoh calls for Joseph to come and interpret the dream, and so he did. And of course, many of you know this, that Joseph says, look, the dream means that for 7 years, you're going to see abundance like you've never seen before in all the land. And we're going to be able to produce more grain and food than we ever have. But then 7 years, there's going to be an incredible famine throughout all the land. And really, they use terminology like the world. They mean like their world of the Middle East, the Near East at the time. So this allows, the interpretation of these dreams, allows Pharaoh and Joseph to come up with a plan to store enough food to not only survive, but to help all the people in the region. And by doing so, in fact, brings power, even more power to Pharaoh, because when people are starving, they'll sell you anything. So actually, he's able to accumulate a great deal of power in Egyptian history after this moment. So it's in this context we read verses 38 through 45 again. Then Pharaoh said to his servants, can we find a man like this, and whom is a divine spirit? So Pharaoh said to Joseph, since God has informed you of all this, there is no one so discerning and wise as you are. You shall be over my house, and according to your command, all my people shall do homage. Only in the throne I will be greater than you. Pharaoh said to Joseph, see, I have set you over all the land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh took off his signet ring from his hand and put it on Joseph's hand and clothed him in garments of fine linen and put the gold necklace around his neck. He had him ride in his second chariot, and they proclaimed before him, bow the knee, and he set him over all the land of Egypt. Moreover, Pharaoh said to Joseph, though I am Pharaoh, yet without your permission, no one shall raise his hand or foot in all the land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh named Joseph Zaphnath-Paneah and gave him Asenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On, as his wife. And Joseph went forth over the land of Egypt. Remember, Joseph is rejected by his own people, his own brothers, his own blood. But then he is treated like a king by Gentiles. He's raised up and he's viewed as a great king because of the blessings he's given him. How similar in tone is that to Jesus being rejected by Israel? And then very shortly, it doesn't take long till the church is mostly Gentiles. And then for hundreds, not nearly 2,000 years, virtually all believers are non-Jewish. So we see this interesting parallel as Joseph as sort of a type, a mini Messiah, pointing to the true Messiah. Jesus was rejected by his people, but quickly found people to exalt him as king among the Gentiles. Jesus, of course, gives many parables about this. Zaphnath-Paneah, that name, that's a fun name, isn't it? Zaphnath-Paneah. If I could be blessed with another son, I'm going to consider that one. What does it mean, though? And a lot of you might look in your footnotes in your Bible right now and go, I know what it means, my footnotes say. But in fact, a lot of scholars debate this, and there's a lot of guesswork about what this means. Now, some believe it means revealer of dreams or revealer of secrets. And I admit, contextually, that's a nice definition, and it might mean that, by the way. Others say it means that God speaks and he lives. Possibly. Don't want to bore you with all the weird, like, linguistic reasons they come up with this, but I think it's kind of a stretch myself. Now, the famous doctor of the church, Latin doctor, Jerome, he believed it meant savior of the world. And after study and ultimately guidance from the Holy Spirit, I believe that is what it means. And perhaps not. This, I'm not telling you I know for a fact. I think it likely means savior of the world. And it fits. It fits what's happening here. And I think you'll see why soon. In verses 53 through 57. When the 7 years of plenty, which had been in the land of Egypt, came to an end, and the 7 years of famine began to come, just as Joseph had said, then there was famine in all the lands, but in all the land of Egypt there was bread. So when all the land of Egypt was famished, the people cried out to Pharaoh for bread, and Pharaoh said to all the Egyptians, go to Joseph, whatever he says to you, you shall do. When the famine was spread over all the face of the earth, then Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold to the Egyptians. And the famine was so severe in the land of Egypt. The people of all the earth came to Egypt to buy grain from Joseph because the famine was so severe in all the earth. God sent Joseph to Egypt to become the savior of the world. He was the savior of this world, this area of Egypt and some surrounding countries. They were all going to starve to death, but because God gifted him, he was able to bring salvation to them from starvation. He was able to maintain these nations. They all would have rotted away, but these nations continued because of Joseph. He was a little savior of the world, though. I mean, I'm sure if you were in that situation, you would see him highly. But he's a tiny savior pointing to a greater savior. And that is his role. He's a type of Christ in this respect, as are many people in the Old Testament in different ways. But Joseph in some astounding ways. 1 John 4:14. We have seen and testify that the Father has sent the Son to be the savior of the world. So we get comments in Genesis 41. Joseph saved the world. Jesus is sent to be the savior of the world. Little, big, pointing to him. So Joseph's brothers, in this context, they come to Egypt to buy grain from him. They need food too. Now, anyone remember that, those dreams about those sheaves and the stars bowing to Joseph? Guess what happens in Genesis 42? They come and they see Joseph, but they don't recognize him. But they bow before him. Oh, the dreams came true. And it's kind of like a paradox. Because had Joseph not told them about the dreams, he wouldn't have been sent to Egypt and then been in a position for them to bow. So you can try, people can find out about God's will and do everything they want to subvert it, but God will use that to bring about his will.
Amen.
Because he's beyond all these plans of men. He's going to bring about his plan. Also, it's very important that they didn't recognize Joseph. Now that their leader had been rejected, the brothers, the Israelites, the ancestors of the Jewish people, they didn't recognize their Savior, so to speak. Likewise, we see the Jewish nation for a long time unable to see that it's Jesus. We show them all this prophecy, all these exciting things, and there's just not a lot of Jewish people being saved, except for about the last 100 years, you're seeing a whole lot of Jewish people being saved. Eyes starting to be opened. But that shouldn't surprise any of us, because no one can recognize Christ from their will. No one can just go, you know, I weighed the evidence, and I did an analysis and figured out Jesus is Lord, so I'm going to follow him. That doesn't really happen to anybody. You're moved by the Holy Spirit, and you're convicted by the power of God for who Jesus is. So until then, he's somewhat of a mystery to you. And that is why children can recognize who Jesus is, and great scholars of the Bible and ancient archaeology cannot, no matter how much evidence they have before them, because it's up to the Holy Spirit to reveal God to people, to reveal Jesus. He has to reveal himself to you. Now, despite how cruelly Joseph's brothers had treated him, he couldn't hold back his compassion forever. He looked at these people who wanted him killed at first, sold him into slavery, told their father that he was dead. And you would think he could have been filled with rage and going, look at the power in him now. But he couldn't hold back his compassion and love for his brothers. And in Genesis 45, 1-3, we read this. Then Joseph could not control himself anymore before all those who stood by. And he cried, have everyone go out for me. So there was no man with him when he made himself known to his brothers. Had everyone else leave. He wept so loudly the Egyptians heard it, and the household of Pharaoh heard it. Then Joseph said to his brothers, I am Joseph. Is my father alive? But his brothers could not answer him, for they were dismayed at his presence. Joseph's been revealed. They're stunned. They probably figured he'd been dead by now or just been some lowly slave still. But they couldn't even answer. Amazed that he had been revealed, really who they were now bowing to. Now, Joseph's life, we see, points to the first and second comings. Rejected by his people, exalted by Gentiles, and then finally, exalted and celebrated by those who rejected him. Now, we see J.C. Ryle. If you don't know who that is, I have a quote from him this morning it's one of my favorite. He's a 19th century expositor. He's considered one of the great preachers of the 19th century. He wrote this, I beseech you to take up anew the prophetical scriptures and to pray that you may not err in interpreting their meaning. Read them in light of those two great pole stars, the first and second advents of Jesus Christ. Bind up with the first advent, the rejection of the Jews, the calling of the Gentiles, the preaching of the gospel as a witness to the world, and gathering out of the election of grace. Bind up with the second advent, the restoration of the Jews, the pouring out of judgment on unbelieving Christians, and yes, he means that, people just call themselves that, the conversion of the world, and the establishment of Christ's kingdom upon earth. Now, Joseph's life helps us see these two great pole stars, the first and second coming of Jesus Christ. His life is sort of a little template that can help you see ahead of time, sort of a symbol to the people at the time of what would happen later, but also something we can look back at now and appreciate that Jesus' life was meant to follow this thing. This is the plan. This is always what it was meant to be. And then we have the wheel of Scripture pointing to Jesus in these different ways to bring him glory from different avenues, different aspects. Now later, Jacob, he's near death. He finds out Joseph is alive. How many of you have had loved ones or people you knew that were near death, but they heard their family was coming to see them, and they rallied? They got strength. And that's what happened to Jacob. And he travels to Egypt. He's able to have just enough strength. And he gets there. He has a few days there. And he meets with his son. And he says, Jacob just, of course, cries, Jacob, Israel. And he says, bring me your two sons, Joseph. So Joseph brings his sons to his father, Jacob, Ephraim and Manasseh. And he says, bring them over here. And then we have Ephraim is here on his left. This would be yours if you're watching. And Manasseh is here. So whoever you put your right hand on, that is the older person. It's supposed to get the greater blessing in this culture. But of course, Jacob, he switches hands like this. Because there's a destiny he knows about for each son. Because Jacob is a prophet. And so he blesses them and he says, these are my sons now. These will be my sons, Joseph. Now, we might be tempted to read this and go, how is that a gift to Joseph? Took his sons. Oh, it's an incredible gift. And this cultural context and the promises made to Jacob, his sons would be the head of the tribes of Israel. So by making Joseph's two sons, his sons, they would themselves become heads of the tribes. And Joseph would effectively have two tribes that he's the father of instead of just one. So he gets a double portion blessing because of everything he went through with and then being restored to his people. So Joseph, because of what he did, suffered, was raised up, saved the world. He's given two tribes. But you know what? Jesus is given tribes from all peoples, nations, and tongues. All people, not just of Israel, but all ethnicities who know him can come to know him. And he is given all of these tribes by God, his Father. So the two of Joseph seem incredible. And Jesus has all peoples bound to him because he is the true great Savior of the world. So to conclude, I would like you to be encouraged to read your Bibles with excitement because you can find these things everywhere. Let them bring you into a place of awe in our Lord. Now, he's the hub and the wheel of Scripture. Don't let studying the Bible intimidate you. There might be difficult spots. There's times where maybe when I was younger, I would have gotten frustrated with a part of the Bible I didn't understand. You know what happens now? Ooh, I'm excited. I'm not exactly sure what's going on here. This should be fun to try to pray and figure out. So get excited about it. And you know, you can come to know your Lord and Savior from new spokes in the wheel and new angles. Some you may have not considered. I find new ones all the time. And when you do, Scripture and our Lord will come more alive for you. Joseph was the Savior of his world. Jesus is the Savior of the world. He saved you from dying in your sins through his death and resurrection. And he's coming back to set the world right. Go tell somebody about it. Let's pray. Lord Father, we want to thank you that you have revealed who your Son is in such incredible ways and in different ways, more than we can wrap our minds around. But you have demonstrated people that before your Son was born in a human body, you have demonstrated who he is in the lives of others that would point toward him. Lord, we would ask that now that we know who he is and he has been revealed, that our lives, they may not point toward him, but we ask that they would reflect who he is and help point people toward him in the sense that they would come to know him and we can be used to mirror him rather than be a shadow of him. Thank you so much, Lord, for your precious word that can be just so exciting and robust and teach us things about who you are and your Son that we wouldn't otherwise know if you hadn't told us. And these things we pray and ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you please stand and join us for our closing hymn?
I have a praise that I told Roger before I left here about a month ago, 5 weeks ago, and last September the church gave me a new Bible, and it was, and I started reading it, and I just kept reading it. By May, I had read through the whole Bible and underlined every line, and I said, I so enjoyed reading. I had read the Bible through several times before, but I just read because I wanted to get through it in 1 year. And I just kept reading this, and I so enjoyed it. And so now I've read, well, I have 1 and 2 Samuel, Daniel, Revelation, and I'm back starting in the New Testament again to read it, and because I had finished it in May. And when I was on my trip back to Worland just a couple weeks ago, I was coming from Oregon, but I went through Washington State, and at Kennebec I filled up with gas, and it was getting pretty late at night, and I could not find a place to park my motorhome. And I kept driving, and it became 11:30 at night. I pulled into a rest area about 30 miles south of Ridgeville, and I was so tired, and so I just put a sheet on my couch, and I opened the window, and I have a little dog that travels with me all the time. And all of a sudden during the night, and this was very unusual for her because she's like a baby, she sleeps all night long, she doesn't wake up for anything, she started walking on top of me, and I couldn't figure out, said, do you have to go potty, crackers? And just kept walking on me. Well, then I smelled exhaust fumes from the vehicle next to me. I had opened the window. My window was right under their exhaust from their vehicle. And it was so hot in Oregon and Washington. And I understand, you know, that they had started their vehicle to put their air conditioning on. And all I was getting was their fumes. Had the Lord not woke her up and walked on me, I would not be here today. And it's such a praise. He takes care of even the lowliest of us. And never forget that, because He loves every one of us. And I've felt His love so much. And just even in all of my travels, I had traveled to Nevada, Oregon, and coming back to Worland, and I'll be here for a couple more weeks, but I just wanted to, Roger had asked me to share about the Bible, that I so enjoy that Bible, and I hate breaking in a new Bible because I underline things. Well, I underlined every line in the Bible, and it's such a joy. Take time to be in the Word, because it is such a blessing. Thank you.
Today's benediction comes from Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 through 26. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. Have a good week in the Lord.